I've known Josh since he was 2 years old, so practically his whole life. Our families were next door neighbours. He was always analysing things and always wanting to know how things worked.
Josh was a friendly young man, very competitive, whether it was academic or on the sports field, very sure of his own abilities and of his own weaknesses too.
He had so many offers on the table after his very stellar career at the university, and I would give him a lot of earnest advice based on my experience, and he steadfastly ignored all of that advice.
I introduced him to Virgin because they were looking to appoint their first ever general counsel. The first thing they said to me after his initial interview was, "Gosh, we thought you were playing a practical joke because this schoolboy walked in." By then he still looked about 18, but that was only stage one, really. Stage two was becoming the CEO of the group.
We had some earnest discussions in a lovely Swiss restaurant about should he, shouldn't he, what would it look like? And he had a delicious amount, I think, of self-doubt at that stage, but it was clear that that was his pathway to stardom.
He'll come to Sydney, he'll set aside a couple of hours in between his hectic meeting schedule. The driver will drop him off, my mum will feed him until he can't move, and then we send him off on his way to run a global business. And after all these years, he still very graciously allows us to call him Joshy.
Please welcome our final awardee for tonight, distinguished alumnus Josh Bayliss. Presenting the medallion is Libby Gain, Vice President of the Auckland University Law Students Society and 2022 winner of the Ernst & Young Global Women in Corporate Finance New Zealand.
I'm guessing that of everyone in this theatre, Josh has travelled the furthest. He goes right around the world as many as 8 times a year. So the question on everyone's lips, how do you look so fresh?
It's a very good question. I went for a very nice run this morning. And I must say, the exercise definitely helps. Other than that, I really couldn't say. I think just genetics.
Tell us a little bit about your role. You are overseeing an incredibly diverse range of businesses at the moment. So how does your role differ from a CEO who's focused on one firm?
I think it is that diversity. The way that I think about the role that I have is really through three different lenses. The first is thinking about the commercial enterprise that each of the businesses represents and ensuring that they're operating as effectively as they can. The second is ensuring that we're doing the most that we can to empower the people who are at the front line of providing an experience to our customers in all of those businesses. And the third is to think about the way that the brand shows up in people's lives, whether that's through the focus that we have on sustainability or whether it's on the focus that we have with working in local communities or whether it's just giving people a really great time when they come to our businesses. And it doesn't really matter whether that's in the aviation industry or in banking or in mobile telecoms or in space. It's got to be differentiated in order to live up to the brand.
Tell us about the famous interview with Sir Richard Branson.
I thought you might ask me that. The famous interview. So I just saw Peter on the screen mentioning the fact. Actually, what happened is I arrived at Richard's house for the interview. And I was let off slightly lighter than some of my predecessors, I later discovered, one of whom was told to go to the top of the stairs, turn right, and it was the third door on the left, which it turned out was the bathroom, and Richard was actually in the bath. So my story was a bit less colorful than that one, at least. I arrived, Richard answered the door and said, "I've double booked you. I have to go to present a music award. Would you like to come back tomorrow or come in the car with me?" So I jumped in the car with him and we crossed London. We got stuck in a terrible traffic jam. a 25 to 30 minute journey took about 2.5 hours, which was just brilliant. He ran out of questions after about 15 to 20 minutes. So I had 2 hours to interrogate him, which I thoroughly enjoyed.
What is that relationship like now?
So it's been 18 years since I have worked with Richard. I've been married to my wife for 21. So similar length of time. And I would say, you know, after that long with someone, the level of trust that he has in me and that I have in him, I think is really quite special. I feel very fortunate that I work for a business which doesn't have millions of anonymous shareholders, but actually is owned by one person who is a family man, and I work with his family very, very closely. And so that trust that is so important, I think, in making decisions under pressure is something that stood us in good stead.
You've championed ESG, sustainability and climate change principles in business. Mm. So what should businesses be doing now?
Well, the reality is that, you know, governments simply don't have the wherewithal, they don't have the tools, and some may say they don't have the aptitude to be able to address the scale of the challenges that we face in the world, environmentally and socially, I think. And so business has a role to play because there is a gap there, but also because it matters very much to businesses. If you want to recruit the best people, if you want to be authentic in what you do as an operator, you've got to be honest in facing into the challenges. And I mean, look, we own two airlines. We're not saying that we're all good and greener than green. What we're saying is that we will be at the forefront of making the change that needs to happen. It needs to happen rapidly. It'll also be good business for us if we are at the forefront of that. It's very expensive to invest in having, you know, the youngest transatlantic fleet, to invest in training people in the most effective way that we can, to be themselves at work. But ultimately, it pays back huge dividends. So I think I would say to all businesses out there, all CEOs out there, if you don't do that, your customers will abandon you. And you will lose your position of power.
Has that happened? Have we crossed that threshold where businesses actually see that we are at a point where this is absolutely critical, not only from a social sense, but from an economic perspective?
I don't think we have. I think we're reaching the point where that transition is now beginning, and certainly there are businesses who get it and who are at least making that change. There is still a really disappointing amount of greenwashing which goes on. You know, carbon offsets are not the answer to fighting challenges of operating global aviation businesses. And yet, the connectivity that comes with flying people around the world is extraordinarily valuable. And so I think it's all about facing into those challenges without being inauthentic and greenwashing.
Have you had a go on ChatGPT?
I have had a go on ChatGPT.
I wondered, outside of climate change, what do you see as being the major disruptive forces in business going forward?
It's a good question. I mean, I do think that actually over the next few years, the effects of climate change on populations, the way that people migrate around the world, the instability and volatility that will create within communities, that's going to be an extraordinarily important aspect of the way that businesses offer their products and services. And at the moment, I think we're in a phase of denial politically. If I look at, for instance, what's going on in Europe with, you know, stop the boats and we're not going to have any more migrants in the UK, all of that sort of thing. That denialism helps nobody. And in fact, while it is creating huge social issues, it's also leaving a huge amount of valuable talent on the sidelines. You know, we began a program after the war broke out in the Ukraine to bring engineers and other skilled people from Ukraine to the UK and the US, train them, find roles for them. And what you realize is actually the education systems in these places, not just Ukraine, but it's a good example, in many ways set these people up extraordinarily well to be resilient and tenacious and bring all of those skills aside from just their practical skills and their role which is incredibly valuable. So I think, you know, business needs to look more broadly around the world at what the source of its real core is going to be.
You have a real global perspective. Is there opportunity for New Zealand in that change?
I think there 100% is opportunity for New Zealand in that change. I think one of the, you know, there's a great asset in this country, which is the can-do mentality. The people of this country, I think, are remarkable. Someone was remarking to me earlier that it's amazing that a New Zealander runs a global group of companies like Virgin. But I meet New Zealanders all the time in all sorts of senior positions around the world. When you think there's 5 million of us out of the global population, it's really quite remarkable. And I think it is that can-do attitude, that directness. And I think if we saw a bit more of that openness and honesty face into the challenges politically, then I think maybe we would start to create more opportunity in this country to create centers of excellence, real technologically based centers of excellence, for example, which could, in this day and age, doesn't matter really where you are. I think we all went into COVID wondering whether Zoom worked. Could you really, you know, speak to someone on a computer screen and have a meaningful interaction? I can tell you, after 18 months of sitting in my garden shed and listing two companies on the New York Stock Exchange by Zoom, you really can. And there's no reason why the fact that New Zealand is the antipodes and on the other side of the world from Western Europe doesn't matter anymore. So I think New Zealand should be very confident, very proud of what it's got to offer and go for it.
In the next few weeks, I believe Virgin Galactic is going to restart some of its flights to space. And you were there with Sir Richard Branson, those pictures that we all saw in New Mexico when he took off in that spacecraft. What was that experience like?
The nearest town to the runway that the aircraft took off from is called Truth or Consequences, New Mexico. And I don't think I could have thought of a better name, a more apt name, because it very much felt like that. As the astronauts all went into the spaceship and reached altitude with the carrier aircraft, the sense of tension and trepidation that was built in the room, a couple of hundred people waiting and many thousands of people outside the facility watching, was extraordinary. And I would say the sense of achievement when it was over, yes, some relief, of course, that it was a big success, but the sense of achievement and what it means, I think, you know, that people talk about the overview effect. And when the astronauts came back, and Richard in particular, started talking about what it had felt like to see the curvature of the Earth, to see the ozone layer, to see the way that cities don't matter, countries don't matter, it's all one thing. I think that was really palpable, and I think it's changed people who had that experience.
Is it going to change you? Are you going to be uploading an Instagram post from 90Ks above?
I don't have social media, so
very wise.
I won't be. So I won't be on Instagram, that's for sure. But my wife has got a terrible fear of flying, and I think the idea of me going in a spaceship might just push her over the edge. So perhaps I'll stay on terra firma.
Might she ever be convinced to join you in New Zealand? Might you ever be convinced to return and head up a New Zealand firm?
I certainly would love to think of being back in New Zealand at some point. Every time I come home, it feels like home. After 25 years away, this is really where my heart is. So it's wonderful to be here.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you here. Please join me in congratulating Josh Bayliss.